All right, guys. So this story right here is tragic. And thank God it wasn't more tragic, as this guy right here, Ryan Le-Nguyen, was accused of shooting a six-year-old boy who was playing on his bike. You know, the six-year-old boy, he may have had his bike in the guy's yard or whatever, right? And allegedly, the dude got mad and shot the boy. Now, this was all caught on camera, okay? And the story gets even worse, but I want you guys to actually take a look at the news coverage of this story before I give my commentary. Take a look.
3 days after this accused shooter shot a little boy, he walks free, making bond on Tuesday. It has this family angry and confused.
And I'm trying to figure out how he got a bond that was so low for trying to kill my kid.
Arnold Daniel trying to figure out why Ryan Le-Nguyen is out of jail after allegedly shooting his son Kobe.
He tried to hit me with a sledgehammer, but that's not gonna work because I'm too fast.
So then what did he do?
Got a gun. Boom! Shot me right here.
It's all on video Saturday afternoon on Candlewood Lane. You'll see kids playing, hear a gunshot, then Kobe realizes he's hit. Le-Nguyen allegedly fired through his front window. The bullet went in Kobe's arm and out the other side.
He's bleeding. He got shot. Kobe got shot. Andrew. Kobe got shot. Oh, police.
Did it hurt?
Yes.
You point to it? Show us where it's at.
Right now, he's not even processing exactly what happened. You know, he don't realize how close he came to not being here, but I realize it.
29-year-old Le-Nguyen is charged with assault with intent to murder. He's apparently had issues with neighbors in the past, and this time, Dad Arnold suspects Le-Nguyen was mad Kobe's bike was in his yard.
I'm irate, really. I mean, I can't function, and I don't know what to do.
A Washtenaw County judge gave him a $10,000 cash bond, which he made Tuesday. This is him walking out, picked up by family. The prosecutor's office shocked at the low bond. They're filing an emergency motion to get it changed. A judge's order not to return home, but it's a piece of paper, says Arnold.
I'm scared for my family. You know, but I'm scared for them because I don't know what he's capable of.
Reporting in Ypsilanti, Jessica Dupnack, Fox 2 News.
All right, guys. So as you can see there, this guy shot the six-year-old boy. It was all caught on camera. Then he's arrested for that. And then he's released after posting a $10,000 bail, right? The community gets outraged and is like, why in the hell is this guy who almost killed a six-year-old boy getting out on such a low bail? And they are 100% right to ask about that. And thank God the criminal justice system listened to them and bought him back in and increased his bond to over $100,000. Now, in my opinion, his bail should be denied, period, right? There should be no amount of money that he can pay to be able to get out, right? He should not be out on the streets because we got this on camera, okay? Again, when I say allegedly shot the six-year-old boy, I'm using that very loosely. Again, we have this on camera. Okay, this man is a danger to his community, but yet he let him back into that neighborhood, right? This man is a danger to children, to kids. And for all intents and purposes, if he is found guilty of this crime, then he should be punished under the maximum extent of the law, right? Now, he was charged with assault with intent to murder, okay? And this was done, again, to a child. And in Michigan, apparently the maximum sentence here is life in prison. And I definitely think, again, like I said, if he was found guilty, he should do life, right? He should do life in prison. I have no remorse for this individual, okay? Because this person is sick, okay? This person has mental issues. Anybody who would attempt to kill a child is a very ill person who does not belong in our society, okay? He must be taken out of society. Whatever type of issues that he had with that child should have been taken up with the parent, right? If the child was playing in his yard or whatever, right? Left his bike in the yard, he should have took that up with the parent. Under no circumstances should you be shooting or trying to harm a child, period. And somebody that's willing to do that obviously has mental issues. And some of you guys may be asking, well, how did this happen? How was this guy able to bail himself out on such a low bond in the first place? Well, we have a hint. Because across the country, we're seeing more activists, prosecutors, being put into place by Democrats that are basically soft on crime, okay? Who's trying to implement progressive criminal justice reform policy that really could be a danger to the community, even though, you know, they're trying to fix, right, the so-called systemic racism in the criminal justice system. Again, some of this stuff that they're doing is creating more harm than it is good because it's being soft on people who actually are a danger to the community. As the prosecutor of this county, right, the new prosecutor, his name is Eli Savit, is one of these new progressive prosecutors, right, that have been put in across the country that I was talking about. He's trying to reform the system, right, to be more racially fair and equitable, okay? That's what he's trying to do. But it looks like because of these new policies, he may have led to this guy basically being put back in the community on such a low bond. He was seeking to end cash bail, okay? So Detroit Free Press wrote about this earlier this year, and I want to read this to you guys so you guys understand what these progressive prosecutors are doing here. Washtenaw County's newly elected prosecutor announced Monday that his office will no longer seek cash bail in criminal cases, saying it discriminates against poor people and perpetuates racial inequities in the justice system. Prosecutor Eli Savit, who was sworn in to office Saturday, says his policy eliminating cash bail is the first of its kind in Michigan. In his first act as the county's top prosecutor, he joins a smattering of prosecutors across the country who have done away with the longstanding process of asking defendants to pay money to get out of jail and ensure they show up for future court hearings. Savit said his office will ask judges to issue restrictions on defendants that are based on ensuring public safety and not their ability to pay. The cash bail system, he said, has cascading ripple effects that trap people in poverty. Proponents of ending cash bail say people are at risk of losing their jobs, their homes, and custody of their children when they sit in jail waiting trial because they cannot afford bail. So this guy's basically saying we need to make it easier for criminals to basically get out of jail. That's basically what he's saying. And guess, guys, I'm not saying that there should not be some type of bail reform. I do agree with some of the arguments in regards to nonviolent people, right? People who have not shown themselves to be violent. Yeah, they shouldn't just be sitting in jail, okay, having to pay exorbitant amount of money to get out, right? I actually do agree with that. What I don't agree with is this policy being extended to people who have shown to be violent. And that may not be the intention. But it seems like in this case, I don't think it's a coincidence that this so-called progressive prosecutor is implementing this policy. And then you see somebody like this man, right? Ryan Le-Nguyen getting out easy. Okay. I don't think that it's a coincidence here. So we can read a little bit more how it worked here. Savit's policy calls for prosecutors to seek the least restrictive release conditions to ensure public safety. Prosecutors can still recommend that a judge deny defendants release from jail in some instances. The Michigan Constitution allows for people to be held without bond when they are charged with certain serious offenses, including murder, first degree criminal sexual conduct, and armed robbery. Additionally, judges can deny bond to defendants convicted of two or more violent felonies in the past 15 years, or if they are charged with a violent felony while on bail, or probation or parole for another violent felony. Now, if we read a little bit further down here, Savit says that whether someone is jailed should hinge on the threat they pose to the community, not their financial means. Quote, eliminating cash bail does not mean that everybody's going free pending trial. It does not mean that we're not considering public safety, he said. All it means is that wealth is no longer part of the equation. Okay, so here's the thing. That's what he says his intent is, okay? However, again, I don't think it's a coincidence that he's implementing this new policy in regards to bail and this thing happened. But this prosecutor is taking ownership of this situation as he has talked about why this happened in the first place, okay? And in an interview, he did talk about, okay, where he might have effed up in this situation, okay? So it says, in an interview Friday, Savit responded to criticisms that no one from his office was present for the arraignment on Monday, June 7, when the initial bond was set. His office provides written bond recommendations to magistrates in every case, but historically it has been relatively rare that prosecutors attend arraignments, he said. Across the state, prosecutors' offices aren't staffed to attend arraignments, he said. But given the seriousness of this case, it is clear someone from his office should have been there, he said, adding he wants to make sure situations like this don't happen again. Quote, I will own it and say that we need to do better going forward, he said. This week, we have put together a plan which is going to have assistant prosecutors at arraignment for pretty serious cases moving forward. All right, so here's the thing. Even though he's saying that, he's basically saying, hey, you know what? Despite my soft policies here, essentially, they made a mistake because people from his office, the prosecutor's office, did not attend the arraignment. And again, I got a question of, okay, why are they not attending arraignments on very serious charges when you've set a soft policy in regards to bonds? Okay, when you have policies like that in place, you got to make sure that those who are potentially very violent, you're not being soft on those people. And again, that's why I said I don't think it's a coincidence that he's implementing this new policy and then this happened. Okay? Because you can't implement a policy like this and then say that, oh, well, you know, we're not really going to oversee the implementation of it. And guys, this is what's wrong with progressive policies, guys. This was wrong with it. It sounds great in theory. And again, like I said, I don't disagree with some of it. I think that, yeah, like I said, I don't think that people who are nonviolent should have to pay an exorbitant amount of money just to get out of jail. I think that is basically a tax on poor people, right? For crimes that really, in my opinion, a lot of it shouldn't really be crimes in the first place. Okay, but at the same time, when it comes to violent people, people who, again, shoot at kids, who attempt murder, who rob, who steal, when it comes to violent crimes, I am a proponent of throwing the book at those people. We are better safe than sorry. Okay, if that person has to wait in jail until their trial, okay, and if they're proven not guilty, okay, great. That's fine. Let them walk free. Maybe they get some payment, okay, because they were found not guilty. But I don't want these people walking free. And quite honestly, he should have been denied bail, period. There should be no amount of money that this guy can pay to actually get out of jail. He should have to wait until he's proven not guilty. And if he's proven guilty, like I said, he should be punished under the maximum extent of the law. But again, my point, guys, is that these progressive prosecutors that are showing up all across the country in cities like Baltimore, New York, Washington, D.C., all these places, right, these liberal cities in which crime is increasing, is not a coincidence. It's the same argument I make in regards to defunding the police. It sounds great until you actually start implementing the policy and you realize that, oh, shit. Criminals are committing more crime because police are understaffed, because they can't respond. So it just emboldens criminals. And really what you're doing is you're hurting those communities that you claim that you're trying to help. That's the problem with progressives. On paper, their policies sound great. In actual implementation, all they really do is hurt people. Okay? And again, I'm not saying some of the stuff they're saying is not right. I think that when it comes to stuff like this, you have to be careful to make sure these soft on crime policies are not extended to people who are actually violent. And like I said, I still think it's a mistake, even $100,000. This man should not be able to walk free, period. So let me know what you guys think. Make sure you like, comment, and subscribe. Most importantly, share a Black conservative perspective. Peace.